Story 1. This happened about 5-6 weeks ago, but I just heard the story firsthand yesterday. I was told the story secondhand weeks ago, but the guy telling the story admitted he did not see some of it and heard even less. A fellow restaurant owner in my area was doing takeout and delivery only during the pandemic. When restaurants in our state were told we could open up for dine-in at 25% capacity, he decided, as did I and many others, to not open as it just wasn't worth it. All orders at his place, whether it be a delivery service or a customer picking up a takeout order, were done outside. Nobody except employees were allowed inside. Orders were taken outside to the parking lot by an employee. This happened a few days after the 25% capacity was announced. Enter Karen and her not-so-Karen friend. They drive up and get out of the car. An employee is delivering a takeout order and sees Karen and her friend. He tells them the restaurant is not open for dine-in. Karen is not happy and proceeds to scream about how sick and tired she is of eating takeout and demands they be served now. The employee tells her that is not going to happen. Karen kicks him in the leg, but the employee manages to still get in front of her so she can't get in the door. Karen doubles down and stomps on his foot. The owner, who witnessed the initial kick and subsequent stomp, tells an employee to call 911 while he runs out to help the employee. Karen, not knowing the police are already being called, screams to her friend to call the cops. Her friend, frozen in place in the middle of the parking lot, can't believe what she is witnessing from Karen. Karen is still trying to get in the door, but can't as the employee she assaulted has fallen in front of the door. This would have been a good time for Karen and her friend to leave. A cop shows up, and Karen thinks he is there to order the owner to let her and her friend eat inside. Oh, delusional Karen. The cop tells her he is there for a reported assault. He calls for an ambulance as a second cop shows up. Karen starts screaming that the employee is faking his injury as a third cop arrives. She screams that she was the one assaulted by everyone within a quarter-mile radius, typical Karen nonsense. The ambulance shows up and starts treating the employee. The owner invites one of the officers inside. Meanwhile, outside, Karen demands to leave. Nope, not happening. She has to stay while this is being investigated. The owner has cameras inside and outside. Karen's tirade is all on camera, including the person who was getting his food delivered by the employee. He had his camera rolling and got audio of Karen in all her glory. When told she could not leave and was going to be arrested, Karen reacted by screaming and pinching the cop on the arm so hard he got a bruise. Her friend never moved during all of this. The owner said her eyes looked like tennis balls bugging out of her head. She was allowed to leave as she did nothing. The employee had two broken toes. Yes, raging Karen stomped that hard. Karen was handcuffed, put in a police car, and taken to jail, screaming all the way about how she would have everyone's badge. Again, typical Karen nonsense. All of this because she was sick and tired of eating takeout. One of the cops came by the restaurant the next day to ask about the employee. He told the owner how, in the last month or so, there was an uptick in people getting arrested, banned from businesses, and receiving trespass orders who have never been in trouble with the law. This age group was approximately 55-70 years old. Yes, Karen, 58 years old, never been arrested, no problems at all, will likely serve some time in jail as well as being sued by the employee. Their reasoning? They are frustrated over this COVID-19 situation. Story 2. Hello, allow me to tell you the tale of Ken and Karen, the darling couple who must think they are the ruling king and queen of entitlement. But their reign is about to come crashing down all around them because of a sleep-deprived, over-caffeinated, sick of the everyday fight, an underpaid employee of Tim Hortons me. It was in the year 2020 during the COVID lockdown. I was working at Tim Hortons almost every day. I worked in a small town, so most of the employees were older and chose to stay home due to the risks. That meant as younger staff picked up most of the shifts. No biggie, bigger paycheck. I, however, ended up getting a temporary promotion to management with little to no training. I learned by trial and error, and when masks became mandatory, there was a bit of pushback. However, people needed their caffeine to feel semi-alive. During COVID, we experienced people spitting at us, throwing their garbage or whatever they could grab, upset because only 3 people were allowed to be on shift to allow social distancing, and they had to wait 15 minutes to get their drinks. It got to the point that the local Royal Canadian Mounted Police would sit and give people tickets for being jerks. Every day at 1:30, Ken would make his appearance. He'd waltz in not wearing a mask, and every time he would be sent back out to get it to put it on, he'd usually just drive off and not order. However, Ken and his companion, Karen, came up with the idea of waiting for the officers to go on their lunch break. Then they came into the store. Ken came waltzing in with no mask. At the time, it was myself and a young girl who was in high school on the floor, as it wasn't a busy day. Our coworker, when I took his temperature at the door, had a fever and wasn't able to work. She told him that he needed his mask before we take his order. He said that it was fine and he'd only take a few seconds. She refused and offered the drive-through as he didn't have to wear one if he did that. Cue the meltdown. He started screaming that we were discriminating against him, that he had rights. At this point, I stepped in and sent the girl to the drive-through. I responded with, "Yes, you have the right not to wear a mask. However, we have the right to work in a safe environment. If Alberta Health happened to come in and see I'm serving you with no mask, I would lose my job. If you choose not to wear a mask, that is your right. But I'm going to have to ask you to use the drive-through." Well, cue the even larger meltdown. He proceeded to tell me I might as well be in Germany forcing Jewish people into train cars and sending them to death camps. At this point, I had been at work since 5 a.m., and frankly, I was done. I immediately began to speak the few phrases of German I know. The guy's mouth was opening and closing, but no sound was coming out. Finally, he was able to spit out an insulting term. I said the few phrases again before asking if he'd like to get his mask so I can take his order. He demanded to speak to my manager. So I did a 360, spread my arms out, and happily said, "Hi, I'm the new manager. How can I help you today?" "Oh, I'm so sorry. Unfortunately, I can't take your order or deal with your complaint until you are wearing a mask. If you don't have one, I'd be happy to provide you with one." The guy absolutely lost it. I watched a 40-year-old man stomp his foot. As he's trying to come up with an insult, his wife walks in, upset that it's taking too long. Lo and behold, no mask. She begins the same speech about me being an awful human being when I hold my hand up and say, "I'm sorry, ma'am, your husband here already gave me that lecture. May you try something else?" She then goes on and on about how they can't breathe with them on, that it's a medical condition. I smile and say, "Well, your breathing seems fine since both you and your husband can scream at us for several minutes without needing to breathe. If you refuse to wear masks, then I have to ask you to leave." "Well, how dare I suggest that? They need their ice caps and bagels, and they aren't leaving until I give them. And it better be free for the inconvenience and disrespect they had to endure." I shrugged and walked away and started making orders for people in the drive-thru. Just as the lovely Royal Canadian Mounted Police officers were walking in the door, Karen began to throw whatever she could get her hands on at us, thankfully missing, but destroying a few of our monitors with napkin dispensers. The officers immediately grabbed both and dragged them outside. She was screaming that I assaulted her first, and she was defending herself. In the process of her flailing around, she hit one of the officers. Ken was calling us all Nazi-loving jerks, saying he was being treated like a victim, and the officers might as well take them to the gas chamber. Now, Ken owns a car shop. In a small town, word travels like wildfire. Ken and Karen not only got a few charges and a ride in the back seat, but Ken had to close his garage as all his customers stopped going. They also got a ban from our location, and the owner made sure to tell any other business that sold coffee about them. They had to drive over an hour to get anything fast food related as all businesses refused to serve them. Friends and family cut ties. They ended up moving. I bumped into them a few months ago, and I couldn't help but ask, wouldn't it have been easier to just wear the mask? Story 3. My sister and her husband are spending a lot of time in the hospital with my baby nephew, who has some health problems. So, I've been dog-sitting Fred, my sister's 16-year-old Dachshund. My neighbor saw me bringing Fred in for the first time and freaked out. She wanted to know why I was bringing in strays, saying we'd end up overrun if the other dogs found out the crazy lady seems to think the Twilight bark from 101 Dalmatians is a real thing. She tried to kick poor Fred. He growled because she was shouting at him. But he's so old his teeth are almost useless. He couldn't have bitten if he wanted to, and she could see that. But she still kicked at him because she's mean. Even when I told her he's my sister's dog, she didn't apologize. She just told me to keep his ugly face away from her garden and stomped off. I dislike this woman. I can cope with her unpleasantness when I'm her target. But Fred is elderly and frightens easily. He's confused, and he misses my sister. He deserves to be avenged. Confronting my crazy neighbor will not help. I have learned this through long experience, and so my petty revenge plan was born. I've had a few issues with slugs getting into my house, escaping the warm weather. I used to just put them near my compost heap. But now, I drop them onto her vegetable patch, along with any others I can find lurking. I've even set up some old pots in shady places to encourage them. I'm committed. Every evening, she removes slugs from her veggies and gives them a good watering. And half an hour later, I drop several big fat slugs over the fence, right on top of her lettuce. By morning, her lettuce looks like lace. She's losing her mind, shining torches into every nook and cranny, looking for slugs every night. She's setting up beer traps and eggshells and cursing all mollusks. It's glorious to behold. Story 4. January. Submit plans to the Homeowners Association Design Committee for a swimming pool. Given the okay and told the project looks beautiful. The lead developer actually contacts the pool builder for a pool of his own. March. Landscaper comes to me asking if my neighbors can have some limestone steps built alongside their house, but they would come into my property by about 4 feet. Knowing that I'm building a pool and landscaping with it, as well as a fence, I say no. He comes back a bit later saying they would like to buy a sliver of my land so they can have their steps. I say no again, though I considered giving them a purposely ridiculous price. They ask him to ask me to sell the land a few more times until I finally tell him they need to approach me directly instead of sending a poor landscape salesman to negotiate. Quick backstory on the neighbors. He's on our state's Board of Regents and is the president of the company my father worked for 35 years. My dad was a sales rep and used to be on commission. One year, the sales team knocked it out of the park, many of them taking home 6 figures. The next year, they were all put on salary. On one occasion, my dad asked for a raise, and my neighbor denied him, saying, "We've looked at your situation and decided you make enough for a family of your size in this area." Meanwhile, my neighbor lives in a gigantic mansion. Fast forward to now. I live in one of the nicest neighborhoods in my town. I have worked super hard to get where I am and wasn't born with a silver spoon. When my neighbors moved in, they have reminded me several times that they're downsizing, whatever. They love their smaller lot because it's easier to maintain. They know who my dad is, but I'm not sure if they know we aren't exactly too fond of them for trying to keep their workforce from becoming as successful as they could. Basically, I'm not giving these people anything. August, the pool gets completed, and I have the fence built. That very evening, I can see the neighbors in their sunroom looking at my yard, and their body language is not positive. A couple of days later, one of the contractors working on the pool tells me he thinks the neighbors aren't happy with my fence. Someone pulled up in a truck and started taking pictures of it, etc. Of course, they aren't happy. Their downsized house is so close to the edge of their lot. My fence doesn't give them much room. The Homeowners Association requires 3 feet of clearance off the property line. The fence is so close to their house, I actually become concerned that it's on their property line. I order a survey, and it comes back saying I'm clear by 5.5 feet in the front and 10 feet in the back. Phew! The same night I get the survey results, the head of the Homeowners Association calls me and tells me the fence is on the property line and I have to move it. I say, actually, I was concerned it was less than 3 feet away, so I had a surveyor verify its position, and it's actually 5 and 10 feet away. He seems surprised but also fairly skeptical. So, I have the surveyor forward the results, and he emails me asking me to have them put stakes in the ground over the property pins so he can see for himself. As I was taking the trash out this morning, I was greeted by the surveyors. They asked me if I was having neighbor problems, and I quickly explained they thought the fence was on their property. I was just as quickly reassured that I was good to go. Anyway, the neighborhood block party and homeowners association meeting are being hosted at the neighbor's house later this month, and I'm not sure whether I should show up and act smug or just throw a pool party in my own yard at the same time.